Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wahlberger, and thank you for joining me on this little journey towards trying to get at polynomial equations and how to solve them. So I left you hanging last time. We had gotten somewhere in terms of a general solution to a cubic equation. So let me remind you that we started with this cubic equation here, c0 plus c1x plus c2x squared plus c3x cubed equals 0. We replaced c0 with t and then looked for a solution x, which was a power series or sort of ongoing series in t with coefficients a0, a1, a2, etc. to be determined. We found that one possibility was that a0 equals 0, and then that generated these subsequent values for the AIs in terms of the original C's. So we got A1, A2, up to A7. And the expressions involved certain terms involving the C's, and we sort of got our head more or less around, you know, which kinds of terms we think are going to appear. And we also looked at the signs, plus or minus, that occur in front of these terms. And now the main challenge is to try to get at the numbers, these coefficients that are in front of these things. And so last time I said, okay, maybe we can just look at the numbers themselves, and I put them in a matrix, and we had something that looked like this. And then I factored those numbers so we could see their prime power decomposition to give us a bit more of an insight into the nature of the formulas that are behind this. So what we want to do is we don't want to necessarily assume that there's going to be nice formulas, but we want to kind of at least start with that general orientation. Okay. So often in mathematics, we want to be looking for the simplest, the easiest kinds of solutions first. It's a kind of a natural evolution. We start with the simplest possibilities and then move up increasingly complicated ones by necessity, ruling out the simpler cases first. But generally, we like to have this orientation that mathematics is ultimately quite beautiful, and that for some miraculous reason, things often work out really pleasantly, at least once you look at things in the right way. Okay, so we look for simple explanations first. Now, I left you with this, and maybe you've had a go, and probably you've found it challenging. Okay, so it's not so easy to figure out, you know, which numbers, which products of small primes are appearing in front of these terms and why. So in this kind of situation, what do we do? Well, we can, you know, make inspired guesses, but there's another kind of general strategy that I want to share with you, which is to sort of go back a little bit and look at what we're doing and saying, are we seeing the entire picture here? You know, the way we're looking at things, we want it to be as broad and encompassing as we can, given the circumstances of what we're looking at. Let me illustrate that in this case here. So what we're really doing is we're looking to see, you know, what this solution X looks like. And I'm going to do that in another way to so we can actually see what's going on. So let me just check my definitions up here. I don't have any definitions. I've cleared them previously. Let me define all these A's. So A sub 0, A sub 1, A sub 2, A sub 3, A sub 4, A sub 5, A sub 6, A sub 7, and I'll check that I have them all there. A0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yes, they're all there. And I'm also going to actually go back and replace the T with C0. Because remember, we were using T in a special kind of way here because it's simpler to deal with because it doesn't have the index. But actually, the T just represents C0. And so strictly speaking, to be as sort of encompassing and as natural as possible, we should replace the T with what it really is. So let me also set T equal to C0. Okay, and now let's have another look at this solution that we have so far found up to degree 7. Okay, there it is. And let me see what that actually is. Okay, so it's got lots of terms. Each of the terms is an expression, actually a rational function in the C's now. And because there's some brackets, let's see if we can just make things simpler by just expanding everything. Expand. Well, did that happen? No, let's put the thing there. Let's try that again. Expand. There we go. Now, it's this expression that I really want to look at, because now what we're doing is we're doing something a little bit more general than we were before. So before, what we had done is we had just looked at essentially the numerators here, the things in brackets, okay? But we had not incorporated the power of C1 in the denominator, and we had also not incorporated the power of T, or C0, which is also actually in the numerator multiplying the A's. So A3 has to really be multiplied by C0 cubed. And that's what we're doing here. So over here now, we've expressed all of these terms purely in terms of the C's. C0, C1, C2, and C3. Okay, now, what do we know? Well, we know that the first column of this table here, and that corresponds to the terms where there is no C3 involved. Okay, so 1, 1, 2, 5, 14, 42, and so on. How can I organize those at the front? So let me organize this thing. Compute. I'm going to use this polynomial collect thing. This allows me to organize a polynomial or an expression in terms of powers of one particular variable. And I'm going to use C3. Okay, so this one here that you see here, this last thing here, this is sort of the constant term with respect to C3. So these are the terms which don't involve any of the C3. These correspond exactly to this first column. And we do recognize the Catalan numbers appearing here. So I want to just stare at this just for a second. So let's just consider the Catalan terms. Okay, because we know what they are. We know what the actual values of these things are. These are these Catalan numbers, which are, you know, the central binomial coefficients, 2n, choose n, and divided by n plus 1. So, for example, this 42, let's have a look at it here. Right? So 42 was the fifth Catalan number, which was, I remind you, 2 times 5, so that's 10... don't need the brackets, 10 factorial over 5 factorial times 5 factorial. That's the central binomial coefficient. And then 1 over 6 times that. Let me just check that that's equal. Yes, that's correct. Okay, so another way of saying what this is, I'm going to rewrite this just a little bit. It's equal to, instead of the 6 times 5 factorial, I'll just make it a 6 factorial and get rid of this 1 sixth. I'm going to make this all a little bit bigger. Maybe you're having trouble seeing it. Let's go to 195. All right. So we're looking at this term here, and we're trying to say, you know, where, how could we predict this 42 just from the nature of things here? Well, there's a C0 to the 6th on top, there's a C2 to the 5th, there's a C1 to the 11th on the bottom. Okay, that's interesting, because there's a 6 factorial on the bottom here, there's a 5 factorial on the bottom, corresponding to these two powers here. And there's, well, a 10 factorial on the top instead of, well, there's an 11 as a power of C1 in the numerator, in the denominator. Let's see how that combines, say, or compares with, say, 132. So 132 is the next one, so that's C5. So that should be equal to, correspondingly, C6, sorry. That should be 12 factorial over 7 factorial times 6 factorial. Let's just see what that is. That is 132, right. Okay, so how could we have figured this thing out or determined it from the nature of the terms here involving C0, C1, C2, and C3? Well, there's no C3, but there's a C0 to the 7 that corresponds to that factorial in the denominator. There's a C2 to the 6 that corresponds to that 6 factorial in the denominator. And there's this 13, okay, which sort of perhaps is responsible for the 12 factorial, even though 12 is 1 less than 13. But that's the same kind of thing that we had appearing here. So what we're seeing is that when we rewrite things by putting all the terms in, so we've got C0, C1, C2, and C3, and we stare at all of the things, and then we concentrate on that part of it that we do actually know about, namely the terms involving the Catalan numbers, then we see that there's a kind of an explanation. So at the level of just those ones, we can kind of guess what the coefficients would be once we've sort of established this pattern. There seems to be a pattern here. Okay, so now obviously let's have a look at some of the other terms and see, you know, if maybe the same kind of thing works. So if we go back up here, let's have a look at this thing here. Let's just grab this term. All right, that's just an individual term. Actually, that's times C3. Okay, all of this times C3, so I better put the C3 there. So I also need to put a C3 here. Okay, that's the corresponding to that. So what would be perhaps the corresponding expression to explain this 84, if we were going to do exactly the same kind of thing or a parallel kind of thing to what we've just seen happens to the Catalan story? Okay, well, we would do a ratio of factorials, and the powers in the numerator seem to end up corresponding to the factorials in the denominator. So what powers are there in the numerator? There's a C0 to the 6, a C2 cubed, and a C3 to the 1. So maybe we have 1 factorial times maybe 3 factorial times 6 factorial, okay. And what should be in the numerator? Well, if it was the same thing that was going on here, we should take this power of C1, which is in the denominator, namely 10, and maybe reduce it by 1 to 9. Let's try it. What is that equal to? Oh, it's equal to 84. Good. Okay. Let's try it again. How about this next one beside it? 330. 330. Okay, remember we have to include this term C3 here. So we'll put that there. Okay, we want to explain that 330. So let's grab the this thing and modify it. So in the numerator now we have there's a 7 factorial. It's going to be a 4 factorial, 4, and it's still a 1 factorial for the C3. And in the numerator, there's a 12 down here, so probably we should put 11. What does that equal to? Oh, it equals 330. This is very cool. Okay, so we have the start of a conjecture. We start a conjecture that the coefficient of the terms involving the C's, C sub 0, C sub 1, C sub 2, C sub 3, are obtained as quotients of products of factorials. The numerator has a factorial for each of the, sorry, not the numerator, let's start with the denominator. The denominator has a factorial for each of the powers of, well, C0, C1, C2, and not C1, because C1 is in the numerator, in the denominator. C0, C2, and C3. In the numerator of the term. Okay, so what I'm talking about here, this denominator, like what this number that we're getting has a denominator of 1 factorial, 4 factorial, 7 factorial, and that corresponds to the powers of C0, C2, and C3 in the numerator of the term involving the C's. While the numerator of the coefficient, maybe I should put that, make it clear, the denominator of the coefficient. And while the numerator of the coefficient is a factorial, which is one less than the power of C1 in the denominator. How does that sound? Something like that. So let's now go back up here. Let's grab this thing again. Here's what we want to explain, right? This thing here was what we wanted to explain. So let's have a more careful look at it. I guess we can get rid of this. We don't need that anymore. Okay, so let's check further. Okay, we don't just want to do two or three and say, oh, now we have the conjecture. No, we want to systematically look if this works. In fact, if I was doing this, on my own, I would check each one of these terms just to make sure that each one of them was working. But let's do a couple and I'll leave the rest to you. So how about this 180? Have we talked about that one yet? So let's look at this term. So that's got 180, and there's also this power of C3, which we better not forget. Okay, so I'll say this has a coefficient, maybe, if our conjecture is right, of what? Let me just copy the form of it and modify it. Okay, so in the denominator here, we should get a 7. We already have a 7, and then it should be a 2, and then another 2. And there's a power of 11 down here, C1 to the 11, so we should get maybe a 10 up here. Okay, hopefully if I evaluate this, I get 180, and I do. That's great. Let's try another one. How about this one out here that has a C3 cubed? So that's going to have a coefficient of, in the denominator. There's no C2 actually. So we'll just have two terms. There's a 7 corresponding to the C0 to the 7, and there's a 3 corresponding to the C3. But there's no power of C2, or if you like it, it's C2 to the 0, so you could put a 0 factorial there, but that's equal to 1. Okay, so, and then what about the denominator? The numerator of this thing, which is the denominator of that. Here there's a 10, and so we should put 1 less than that, which is a 9. And what is that equal to? 12, that's the same thing. Okay, so this is very exciting, okay? It means that potentially now we have a kind of a process that allows us to predict what the coefficients are going to be for these terms which are made out of the C's, the coefficients of the original equation that we were going to solve.